In this, the first of two lectures on Aristotle's Poetics, we shall consider how Aristotle took Plato's negative understanding of mimesis and converted it into a powerful method for creating poetry, particularly tragedy, worthy of philosophical consideration. Now in this lecture, lecture 3, we will look at Aristotle's view of mimesis and plot. In the next lecture, lecture 4, we will look at his view of character and catharsis. And in both of these lectures, I will be using the famous play Oedipus by Sophocles as my example, because that's Aristotle's example in the Poetics. But first, a few preparatory remarks about Aristotle. I think many of you know this, but you all know the famous little diagram. First, there is Socrates, and he is a 5th century figure. Then his pupil is Plato, and he straddles the 5th and 4th century. And then Plato's star pupil is Aristotle, and Aristotle is fully a 4th century figure. And then, as you all know, Aristotle was supposedly the tutor of Alexander the Great. That's the easiest way to remember a sort of chronology back then. Now, Aristotle, again, Plato's star pupil, but Aristotle broke company in many ways with Plato. In fact, Aristotle was responsible for bringing philosophy back to earth. For Aristotle, the essence and reality or form of a thing now resides within rather than above. So if Plato turned things on their head, took the real world here and put it up there, Aristotle restored it. Now, this earth is the real world. Again, that doesn't mean he denies heaven or God, but now the real world is this earthly world. And the form or reality of something does not exist up there, but inside, within, in this world. A few more remarks. Aristotle was one of the most systematic thinkers who ever lived. Very systematic, very logical, very scientific, if you read any of Aristotle's work. In fact, the Western presupposition that all of knowledge can be broken up into discrete little packages called disciplines comes directly from Aristotle. Before Aristotle, you had the pre-Socratics, and they talked about all the different disciplines all together. Aristotle really was the one who invented this idea that there's one discipline here, science, and particularly, you know, biology, chemistry, English, history. All of this idea of disciplines, what students call majors, that really goes back to Aristotle. This systematic man took all of knowledge and broke it into categories. And I think it's true. Most people believe that Aristotle knew everything that there was to know at his time. We couldn't do that now. There's too much to know. But he was able to do it. And in fact, Aristotle wrote a treatise on every facet of knowledge, from politics to astronomy, physics to ethics, rhetoric to poetry. Every discipline, he wrote a treatise on it. Amazing man, amazing mind. Now, in his Poetics, Aristotle treats poetry as a separate discipline with its own specific laws, its own unique tools, and its own proper ends. Remember in the last lecture, one of the way to deal with Plato is to say poetry is something different than philosophy? Well, Aristotle makes poetry a discipline. Its own laws, its own tools, its own goals. That's unique. Finally, I just want to mention, if you ever read any Aristotle, you will notice that Aristotle is very choppy. In other words, when you read his books, they read like outlines from the teaching company. Do you know why? Most people believe that we don't have anything that Aristotle wrote. All we have are the notes his students took. I wish my students took such good notes, but that's why they're a little bit choppy, we think. All right, let's talk about Aristotle's Poetics. In the Poetics, Aristotle radically redefined the Platonic notion of mimesis. Remember, mimesis or imitation was negative for Plato. For Aristotle, it is positive and natural. As children, Aristotle says, we learn primarily from imitation. That's how we learn, by imitating. Even as adults, he says, we still delight in recognizing and contemplating copies. If you go to a puppet show with your kids, you enjoy figuring out who the characters are as much as they do. You don't scream it out like they do, but we enjoy imitation. It is natural to us, even as adults. Now, Aristotle thinks that behind this deep felt love of imitation is an instinctual desire for harmony. We want to find harmony and unity, recognition in our world, and that's linked to this love of imitation or mimesis. Now, in poetry in general, and in the well-constructed plots of great tragedies in particular, Aristotle found the perfect food to feed our innate desire for order, balance, and unity. We desire order, balance, and unity, and Aristotle says the best place to find that is actually in poetry, and particularly in a well-constructed tragic plot. That's where, even more than philosophy in a way, it's poetry. Now, according to Aristotle, it is precisely the imitative or mimetic process that allows the tragedian to construct a perfect unified plot. These plots that strike our need for unity and for order, the way those plots come about is because the tragedian uses mimesis, or what we call the mimetic process. Now, what the mimetic process does is it takes an action or a story, the Greek word is praxis, and it takes that story that is long and haphazard and episodic, okay? Stories don't have a lot of unity and cohesion. They just ramble on, right? One episode to another. In the vernacular, one damn thing after another, right? One episode, another episode, another episode. That's a story. Well, the mimetic process takes that story and transforms it into a plot that is focused and unified. The word for plot is muthos. It's where we get our word myth. Now, if you want to impress your friends at a cocktail party, tell them, according to Aristotle, the mimesis of a praxis is a muthos. That's a mouthful, and it means the imitation of an action or story is a plot. Let's see how we go from story to plot. Let me give you an example. The story of a man, say myself, begins with his birth and ends with his death, and includes all the various incidents that occur in between. The story of my life is episodic, one thing after another, year one, year two, all the way up to my death. But a plot that was constructed around that biographical story would confine itself to a single day in that lifespan when all that is most essential to that life comes to a head. In other words, if you want to write a plot about my life, take that one day in my life when everything falls together. We've all had days like that, sometimes for good, sometimes for bad. But see, a plot is not interested in everything. It's interested in a focused, unified bit, something that is representative of the whole life. Now, whereas the events in a story follow each other in simple chronological order, boom, 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 the events in a plot should move forward in accordance with necessity, probability, and inevitability. Stories don't. They just ramble on. A plot, necessary, probable, and inevitable. And Aristotle uses those words about 15 times in the very brief Poetics. It's very important to him. Another way to put this is, according to Aristotle, the plot is life with all of life's contradictions purged out of it. Think about Plato. The story of my life is part of the world of being. The story of my life is part of the world of becoming. The plot of my life is part of the world of being, because the plot is perfect and unified and somehow eternal. So again, we're turning Plato on his head here. We're saying mimesis takes us closer to the world of being. To imitate life, mimesis, is to present life not as it is, but as it should be. Not as it manifests itself in an imperfect world, a world of becoming, but how it would appear in a more perfect world, a world of being, where, A, there is a necessary link between cause and effect, B, the stable, meaningful laws of probability determine action, and C, a sense of inevitability of a higher controlling fate is felt. Again, necessity, probability, inevitability. Now, how can someone discern between an episodic play and an Aristotelian plot? Because some plays are not Aristotelian, they're episodic. What's the difference? Well, in an episodic play, what Aristotle would say is an inferior play, there is no internal cohesion between the scenes. But in an Aristotelian plot, there is a causal relationship, cause and effect, between each scene that propels the reader forward towards the unstoppable conclusion. Let me give you some phrases Aristotle uses. And even though Aristotle wrote in Greek, we always use these phrases in Latin for some reason, because Aristotle was read in Latin for many years. There are two different Latin phrases, post hoc and propter hoc. Post hoc in Latin means after this. Propter hoc means because of this. Stories are post hoc. Plots are propter hoc. Stories are post hoc after this, because again, they're chronological. One damn thing after another. Plots are propter hoc because of this, because there's a cause-effect relationship. In other words, scene B comes after scene A, not because of simple chronology, but because there's a cause-effect relationship between scene A and scene B. Hopefully this will become even clearer as we go along. Let me give you a very concrete example. When watching an episodic play, how can you tell the difference? Instead of play, let me use movies, because we see movies today. How can you tell when you're at an episodic movie, one that just rambles along? You know how? Halfway through the movie, you get up, you go to the bathroom, you buy some popcorn, you buy some soda, you come back, and you haven't missed anything. But if you go to a movie that is an Aristotelian plot, you know how you can tell? Halfway through the movie, what? You've got to go to the bathroom. But you are not going to leave, because you know if you miss 5 seconds of this movie, it's all going to fall apart. And so your legs are all tied up in knots waiting, because you don't want to leave, because everything is so linked together that you don't want to miss literally even a second. That's how you can tell the difference between a story and a plot. And I should say, classic Hollywood plots from the golden age of Hollywood, what I love, the 30s and 40s, they followed Aristotle to the letter. If you watch those old movies like Casablanca and all, they're very unified, not episodic. And you don't want to leave those movies because they're so tightly constructed. Now, what I'm going to do is to illustrate everything I've told you with examples from Oedipus the King. And since, in case you haven't read that or haven't read it in a while, I'm going to give you a very quick précis of Oedipus right now. It's not in your outline. I'm going to just go over it. And I'm going to give you both the story of Oedipus and the plot. The story of Oedipus begins when Jocasta and Laius, the queen and king of Thebes, receive a prophecy that their son will kill the father and marry the mother. Well, when Laius, the father, hears this, he says, no, no. He takes the baby away from his wife, kicking and screaming probably, and takes his feet and like pierces them and ties his ankles together, and then leaves him up on a hill to die. Now, Oedipus means swollen foot. That's where the name Oedipus comes from, because his feet were tied together. He would have died up there, but a good old messenger, like in the Snow White story, takes pity on the baby Oedipus and rescues him. He doesn't tell anybody, but he takes the baby Oedipus, carries him far away, and he meets another another herdsman from the city of Corinth. And he tells him the situation and says, please, take this baby away, because they're trying to kill him. And so off goes the Corinthian herdsman. Of course, the herdsman from Thebes never tells anybody what he did. All right. We get to Corinth now, and baby Oedipus arrives at a very opportune moment, because the king and queen of Corinth have not been able to have any children. And so what they do is they adopt baby Oedipus as their own, but they never tell him he's adopted. Jump ahead, he's a teenager now, 16, 17 years old, he's at a party, somebody gets drunk and makes fun of Oedipus and says, Oedipus, you're a bastard, you are not your father's son. Well, Oedipus, who's always an impulsive, rash kind of guy, says, what? I must know the truth. And so he rushes out to the Oracle of Delphi, the great prophetess, and wants to know the truth. Am I my father's son or not? Well, you know what happens? The Oracle will not even receive him. The Oracle spurns him as if he were contagious and says to him, get out of here. You are a contagious, evil man. You will kill your father and marry your mother. Well, Oedipus, who always wants to be in control of things, says, I'm going to escape my fate. And so he runs away from Corinth as fast as he can. Runs, runs, runs. And as he's running away, on a road with three forks, he comes upon an entourage. There's a group of people going out on a hunting party. And they run into each other on the road, and they both refuse to move aside. Oedipus can be rather stubborn. A fight ensues, and Oedipus kills all of the people, except one farmer who escapes and runs away. Well, guess who the leader of that pack is? It's his father, Laius, who's dressed in common clothes to go in this hunt. All right, he doesn't know he's killed his father or the king of Thebes. He continues on his way, and he meets up with the Sphinx. You know, part woman, part eagle, part lion. And the Sphinx has been terrorizing the city of Thebes because she won't let anybody go in or out. And if they do, they have to answer her riddle. If they answer her riddle, she'll leave. If they don't, she devours them. Everybody's afraid. Some tried, they can't make it. They're devoured. Oedipus, who is ever the riddle solver, says, I'm not afraid. Ask your question. If we have time, maybe I'll tell you the riddle. I'll tease you. But anyway, Oedipus answers the riddle. The Sphinx kills herself. And Oedipus walks into Thebes, and everybody hails him as a hero. And guess what? Thebes has just recently lost her king by unknown origin. And so they make Oedipus their king. And of course, as king, he marries Jocasta, the queen. He doesn't think, hey, she's old enough to be my mother. He marries her. And they have four children together, two boys and two girls. All right. Years pass by, and all of a sudden, a terrible plague falls upon Thebes because of this horrible thing that's happened. And this is when the plot of Oedipus the King, I've told you the story of Oedipus the man, the plot of Oedipus the King begins. There's a plague that's killing the people and the livestock, and Oedipus, who loves his people, loves the Thebans, and is committed to truth, decides, I'm going to find out what the cause of the plague is and solve it. And so, during the course of the play, and the plot of Oedipus the King takes place in about 12 hours, a little bit less, 6 hours. It's amazing. And everything happens real quick. And he has already sent his brother-in-law, Creon, to the oracle. And the message comes back to tell Oedipus that the plague is caused because the killer of the former king, Laius, has never been caught. He must be exposed. And so Oedipus very rashly says, I will find out the killer. I will seek the killer of Laius as if he were my own father, right? A lot of what we call dramatic irony in the play Oedipus. Well, things happen fast. There's a blind prophet named Tiresias who comes in. The prophet tells Oedipus, don't follow out this search. Stop. Leave the unknown unknown. But Oedipus wants to know the truth. He's committed to solving riddles and to helping his people. And so he pushes it forward. And what he does is he calls for that. Remember, there was one farmer that survived the killing of the king. They decide that's the king. He calls him. But while he's on his way to Oedipus, all of a sudden, this messenger from Corinth arrives. And the messenger is bringing news to Oedipus that his father, who he thinks his father, has died. And therefore, he is now the king of Corinth. And Oedipus is sad, but also happy. He says, ha, I've beaten the prophecy. I'm not going to kill my father. Well, guess what? Guess who the messenger is? The messenger happens to be the very herdsman who brought the baby Oedipus to Corinth. And he says, are you worried about that? Let me give you good news, boy. That's not your father and mother. You're a foundling. I found you up on the mountain. They're not your parents. And now Oedipus thinks he's escaped his fate. Then in walks the farmer, the one man who escaped the murder of Laius. Guess who he is? He's the herdsman who gave the baby Oedipus to the Corinthian herdsman. Well, as everything falls together in this very organized, unified plot, the truth comes out. As soon as it's known, Jocasta, in horror, runs back to her bedchamber and hangs herself. Then Oedipus, in a fit of despair, runs into the room, seizes the brooches from her dress, and puts out his eyes. Hideous scene in the play. It's off stage. But he comes back blinded with blood, and he tells his people that they must exile him because he is, in a way, kind of contagious, again, sort of evil, a taboo, and he must be kicked out of the city. Now, the story of Oedipus continues. He eventually goes to Athens, where he sort of reconciles and dies almost a hero in a way. But the plot of Oedipus the King concerns that one day during which Oedipus discovers who he is. That's the plot. The story of Oedipus, life to death, the plot of Oedipus, just the one day. Now, I'm going to explain to you why this is important. Let's look at the difference between the story of Oedipus and the plot of Oedipus, and you will understand how powerful the mimetic process is. All right, back to your outline if you want to look. The story of Oedipus the man is filled with long, boring stretches during which the tragic pieces of Oedipus's life slowly coalesce. It just goes on and on. I've given you it fast. But the plot of Oedipus the King is concentrated into an intense, dramatic period of less than a day during which all the secrets of his life are revealed. And you might guess that during the course of the plot, there are what we call flashbacks. So we learn the whole story, but in the form of a very tight plot. That's what classic Hollywood did, right? Think of all the flashbacks in Hollywood to allow it, like Casablanca, right? To allow a unified setting, you have flashbacks that tell you everything that's happening. A lot of Hollywood plots start with the death of somebody and then go backwards, right? That's a very Aristotelian notion. Another difference between story and plot. The story of Oedipus is a despicable tale about a man who kills his father and marries his mother. The plot of Oedipus the King is about a man who discovers late in life that he has killed his father and married his mother. That is to say, whereas the story of Oedipus is about the committing of a taboo sin, the plot of Oedipus is about the triumph of self-discovery. It is wrong to say that the plot of Oedipus the King is about a man who kills his father and marries his mother. That's what the story is about. The plot is about a man who discovers late in life that he's made a shambles of his life. Self-discovery. And that's scary. I think all of us have a fear we're going to find something hidden in our past. Not that we killed our father and married our mother, but some hidden past. And so it's the story is despicable in a way, but the plot is noble. It's about self-discovery, discovering who you are, even if that kills you. And it's tragic. It's about self-discovery. Another, in terms of his overall story, Oedipus is one of the most pathetic of all men. A man trapped by a cruel and evil fate that he cannot escape. Why should he interest us? The poor guy's a puppet. But in the confines of the plot, he is a noble, courageous man who chooses to seek out the truth about himself, no matter the consequences. It was prophesied that he would kill his father and marry his mother. It was not prophesied that he would find out. The finding out was done totally by Oedipus. And so, in the finding out, he is in control of his fate. To sum up, the story of Oedipus is the raw material for a vulgar, made-for-TV movie, the kind of thing you see on Lifetime these days. But the plot of Oedipus is one of the great, noble works of all times. Talk about strange, raw material. Again, that's the kind of stuff you see, all sorts of exploitation stuff. The plot is great, and it's all because of mimesis. All right, having defined the nature of the unified, mimeticized plot, Aristotle goes on to enumerate the many elements that work together to create the perfect plot. First of all, he says, a unified plot has a beginning, a middle, and an end. That sounds obvious, but it wasn't obvious till somebody said it. Very systematic. Beginning, middle, end. Unified. He tells us that a good plot should be shaped like an inverted V or a pyramid. As you go up the inverted V, you have the rising action. At the top, at the point, is the climax. And after the climax, you have the falling action. The word is denouement, or really French, or unraveling. That's, again, the way it's organized. Many of you may have learned that in high school. High school English teachers love this stuff. A few more points about the plot. Okay? In the best plots, Aristotle says, the climax is marked by what he calls a reversal or a recognition. Now, every tragedy should have a climax. But in a simple tragedy, there's just a climax. But in a complex plot, and that's what he prefers, that climax is linked to a reversal or a recognition or both. Let me define these terms. A reversal, the Greek word is a peripeteia. A reversal occurs when the fortune of the hero moves suddenly from good to bad or bad to good. That's the reversal. Everything's good, suddenly bad. Everything's bad, suddenly good. That's a reversal. Now, in Oedipus, the messenger from Corinth thinks he brings good news that will free Oedipus from fear, but that very news leads to his destruction. There's a reversal because at that point Oedipus thinks, I've escaped. He's not my father. I've escaped. But that same good news leads to bad news. That's called a reversal. Everything's going great and then suddenly it plummets. That's tragedy. What is a recognition? The Greek word for recognition is anagnorisis. A recognition occurs when the hero moves suddenly from a state of ignorance to a state of enlightenment. Guess what? It's the same scene in Oedipus. Oedipus goes from not knowing who he is to knowing who he is. Now, you might guess, in the best plots, Aristotle says, the reversal and the recognition happen at the same time. And that's what happens in Oedipus. And that's one of the reasons Aristotle treats Oedipus as the perfect plot. Okay? Let's move on to one more thing. The best plots, according to Aristotle, do not end with a deus ex machina. Now, what is a deus ex machina? Latin again. It means God from the machine. How are you going to end the perfect plot? You don't end it with a deus ex machina. What is a deus? The deus ex machina was a crane-like device that allowed an actor to descend onto the stage in the guise of a god or a goddess. Again, Greek theater was very sparse, no props or anything, no settings, but they had this crane that you could lower somebody onto the stage. It was wonderful, a little bit of special effects. Now, the deus ex machina was used by dramatists in ancient Greece as a way of resolving from above all manner of difficulties and misunderstandings in the play. Let me give you an example. You're watching a tragic a tragedy. Everything's all mingled up. Nobody knows who they are. Everything's about to go bad. When suddenly, they hear a whirring sound, and out of the blue descends Athena. And Athena looks down to the people and says, "All right, everybody, stop. Listen to me. Don't marry her. She's your mother. Don't kill her. She's your sister. Be nice to her. She's your cousin twice removed." I'm being silly, but that's what happens. The god comes down and sets everything to right. Now, as you can imagine, Aristotle did not like this because he considered this an artificial way to end a plot. To him, it's as if the tragedian got to the end and didn't know what to do, so he just, boom. I'll bet you've all seen movies that are great but have a terrible ending. And you say, that ending has, that ending's contrived. It has nothing to do with the plot. That's what Aristotle's talking about. Now, what did he want? He felt that the plot should be strong enough to resolve itself in a manner consistent with necessity, probability, and inevitability. In other words, if you construct your plot well enough, it will actually resolve itself. In other words, you know what I love when I go to see a movie, like a mystery movie, where I get to the end and I have not guessed the ending. But when it happens, I say, ah, yes, that's the right thing that should happen. Haven't you all had that experience? And in novels, too, especially mystery novels. You never would have guessed it was Colonel Smith. But when it's revealed, you say, of course, I should have got it. All the clues were there. That's an Aristotelian plot. It's one that resolves itself. Indeed, Oedipus, to go back, is so well constructed that the final tragic revelation of Oedipus's parentage does not seem contrived. It arises naturally out of the plot. Now, if you stop and think about Oedipus, it's very contrived. Oh, it just happens that a messenger from Corinth comes on the same day that the other messenger comes. I mean, it's contrived if you think about it. But while you're watching the play, everything is so much inevitability, necessity, and probability that you say, yes, it makes sense. That's the way a tragedy should end. That's a higher kind of mimesis, because it's the way things should happen. Now, Aristotle's prejudice against the deus ex machina reveals his strong commitment to a balanced, rational universe in which all makes sense. Remember I said in lecture one that our presuppositions about God, man, and the universe determine our view of art. Well, Aristotle had a view of the universe that was logical. He believed in a very logical, rational, ordered God. And so his philosophical presupposition led him to prefer plots that work that way. Aristotle believed that nothing was arbitrary or hectic in this world, and therefore the plot should not be arbitrary and hectic. But I want you to know that there were some great tragedies, particularly by Euripides, that have deus ex machinas that work. Even Sophocles used deus ex machinas. Now, why do you want to use it? Think about it. Maybe your view of the universe is that sometimes things go wrong and God or somebody else has to step in and fix things up. So see, whether you choose the deus ex machina or the plot resolving itself determines on your view of the universe. The great Molière, the play Tartuffe, ends with a deus ex machina where Louis XIV, the Sun King, steps in and solves all the problems. That's because politically, the belief in Louis as the Sun King, the monarch who watches like God and solves all problems. So again, I want you to understand that the deus ex machina has been used for good reasons, but Aristotle's view eschewed it. Finally, it should be noted that Aristotle argues forcefully that the plot is the central, most important element of a tragedy. The plot is both the end and the soul of tragedy. Aristotle believed that the plot is primary, character is secondary. That's different. Most of us, when we go to a movie or a play, we look for good characters rather than good plots. Aristotle believed the plot is more important than the character. Very important to understand Aristotle's view of tragedy. All right, in our next lecture 4, we will move on to look at Aristotle's notion of the tragic character and of catharsis.